The wind and sea quickly stopped our forward movement, and we began to drift backward over the spot where the skiff had been. Big Alec's black head and swarthy face popped up within arm's reach, and all unsuspecting and very angry with what he took to be the clumsiness of amateur sailors, he was hauled aboard. Also, he was out of breath, for he had dived deep and stayed down long to escape our keel. The next instant, to the perplexity and consternation of the owner, Charlie was on top of Big Alec in the cockpit, and I was helping bind him with gaskets. The owner was dancing excitedly about and demanding an explanation, but by that time Big Alec's partner had crawled aft from the bowsprit and was peering apprehensively over the rail into the cockpit. Charlie's arm shot around his neck, and the man landed on his back beside Big Alec. "More gaskets!" Charlie shouted, and I made haste to supply them. The wrecked skiff was rolling sluggishly a short distance to windward, and I trimmed the sheets while Charlie took the wheel and steered for it. "These two men are old offenders," he explained to the angry owner, "and they are most persistent violators of the fish and game laws. You have seen them caught in the act, and you may expect to be subpoenaed as witness for the state when the trial comes off." As he spoke, he rounded alongside the skiff. It had been torn from the line, a section of which was dragging to it. He hauled in 40 or 50 feet with a young sturgeon still fast in a tangle of barbless hooks, slashed that much of the line free with his knife, and tossed it into the cockpit beside the prisoners. "And there's the evidence, Exhibit A, for the people," Charlie continued. "Look it over carefully so that you may identify it in the courtroom with the time and place of capture." And then in triumph, with no more veering and yawing, we sailed into Benicia, the king of the Greeks bound hard and fast in the cockpit, and for the first time in his life a prisoner of the fish patrol. End of section 2.